To support the production of more high-quality content, consider supporting us on Patreon or a YouTube membership. Additionally, consider visiting our parent company, EarthOne, for sustainable living made simple. In the last video in this series, we went through an intuitive example, starting from scratch and layer by layer hand-building a neural network that can classify patterns in an input image. The focus of this video then will continue right where the last one left off, as we delve into how these networks are actually able to learn. When setting our network up in the last video, we handpicked certain nodes that had non-ambiguous receptive fields of either all black or white pixels, which led to non-ambiguous weighted values, which finally led to non-ambiguous outputs. Now this idealized system, while great to learn the fundamentals of deep learning, more specifically the structure of neural nets and how they build representation, is not how deep learning systems actually learn. To see these systems' true learning capabilities, let's go back and tweak some things in our network. First off, we'll keep the input and output layers the same, that being the number of nodes in them, what their receptive fields are looking for, and the values we define for them. Going on to the hidden layers is where things require changes. In our last video, we set the weights for our network by hand to get the desired results we were looking for in the receptive fields of the nodes. While our example is simple and this is doable, for more complex real-world applications, this is infeasible or even impossible. Additionally, as stated in the first video in this deep learning series, we want these networks to be able to build representation on their own, not have it set by hand. Okay, so backing up, if changing weights results in different receptive fields, then we can infer that getting the right combination of weights in a neural network is what it means to be able to detect patterns in the output, and thereby, the process of getting those correct weights is learning. In even our simple examples case, we have 181 potential weights. This calculated by multiplying the 9 nodes in our input layer with the 9 nodes in our first hidden layer, then adding to that the 9 nodes in our first hidden layer multiplied with the 4 in our second layer, and following the same pattern for the rest of the layers to arrive at 181. The reason our network seemed so simple before is because we didn't draw out the weights that were approximately 0 or ambiguous for the sake of simplicity and visual representation. However, now that the network has defined what weights are important, we have drawn them all out. Now, it would be difficult to visually represent the effect 181 weights would have on the output decision space. So, we will take a quick tangent from our primary example and show their effect in this simple network with 12 weights. Here we have our nodes labeled with the inputs as X and Y, the outputs as P and Q, and the hidden layer nodes as A1 through A3. We also have all our weights labeled from W1 through W12. Going off the formula where a node in a non-input layer is the sum of all the weighted inputs into it, we then end up getting these equations for our nodes. To see this visually, let's plot out the output node equations, with where P is greater than Q in red, and where P is less than Q in blue. In other words, our decision boundary is at where P equals Q. As you can see, as we alter these weighted values in our network, the slope of our decision boundary changes. Now, you may be wondering why we are only producing linear, in other words straight lines, no matter how much we change the weights. This is because all we're doing with our network is adding together a bunch of linear equations, the result of which is another linear equation. So then, how do we go about adding nonlinearity so our network can be used for more complex datasets? Well, as mentioned in the last video in this series, beyond activation functions bounding the flow of data in a network, they also serve to add nonlinearity to a network. To see this, we will apply an activation function to our hidden and output layer, say the sigmoid function. Viewing this effect on our output decision boundary, you can now see that changing weights can produce nonlinear boundaries, in other words, a line that could bend around data points. Now the purpose of this little tangent we went on was to show the effect that weights have on the output of a neural network. As you saw, as we hand-tuned the weights, they were able to mold around various data points. The goal of deep learning is for this weight tuning to be done by the network itself. To see this process of learning in our pattern recognition example, we'll set all 181 weights to random initial values. You can think of all these combinations of weights like knobs that have to all be tuned to the right setting to find an output pattern. As a side note, we are keeping the number of nodes in these layers and their activation functions the same as in the last video, as these are hyperparameters and will be discussed in the next video in this deep learning series. Now coming back on topic, as stated earlier in the last video, since we had a perfect neural network, whatever we input to the system would always be perfectly defined in the output. That being, if we input this image of a cross for instance, then only the cross node would be active, or if we input this gibberish into the image, then we would get all non-ambiguous results in the output. We can consider this output value from our perfect neural network the truth value, and now that we have reset all the weights, our network has to get to this point of truth by itself. The values our network is outputting now may be close or far away from ground truth. Most probably the results will be terrible, or as Grant from 3 Blue 1 Brown would call them,
utter trash.
To see how far off this trash is from the ground truth value, neural networks incorporate an error term for each output node. This error term is referred to as a squared error, subtracting the value we got from the ground truth and squaring it. We then take all these error terms and sum them up, getting what is called the sum squared error term, otherwise known as the cost of the classification of input data. When the values we are getting are close to truth, then the cost of our network is low, and when far, the cost is high. The goal then is to get our weighted values close to ground truth, so we can get this cost function value as low as possible. In our example, our neural network function takes in 9 values, the input pixels, and outputs 4 values, which identify the patterns that are observed in the image. And it does this, as stated earlier, by tweaking all the parameters of the system, in our case, the 181 weights. The cost function then is a layer of complexity above this. It takes as its input the parameters of our neural network function, the 181 weights, and outputs one value, the cost of them, which is a measure of how accurately those weights describe our data. The parameters of our cost function is lots and lots of training data, hopefully well-labeled training data, as we'll discuss later in this video. This labeled training data serves as a ground truth for which our cost function has to minimize for. Now to better visualize how this is done, instead of thinking about a complex cost function, in our case with 181 variables, for the sake of explanation, let's condense all those weights into one variable. So now that we have this, let's go through the process of how we can find the value of w that minimizes a cost function. Plotting this on a chart, we have the weight on the x-axis, and the error at that weight on the y-axis. For anyone who has taken basic calculus, you'll know that to find the minimum of this function, we take the derivative of it and solve for zero. Now going beyond the simple parabola with one global minimum, how would we go about solving for this cost function, which you can see has multiple local minima? How then do we take our weight, which was set randomly initially, and get it to the global minimum? Well, we can take the slope of the function, the change in error, over our weight. If the slope is positive, in other words increasing error, we shift the weight to the left, and if negative, we shift it to the right. This increment we shift the weight by in each iteration is referred to as a step size, a hyperparameter we will discuss more about in the next video in this series. Coming back on topic, you can see that after enough iterations, we will eventually reach some local minimum. An analogy often thrown around is a ball rolling down a hill and landing in a valley. You can see here that the ball can land in many different valleys, local minima, depending on where the weight was randomly initialized. Keep this fact in mind for future discussions we will have. Finding the local minimum is fairly doable, but the global minimum, the point with the least error, is incredibly difficult. Now coming back on topic, expanding our cost function for another weight, we reach a three-dimensional surface to navigate on. As a side note, you can see for each additional weight, we enter the number of weights plus one dimensional space. So in this case with two weights in 3D space, we are looking for the x and y directions to navigate on, the input weight surface, that will minimize the cost function, which is the z-axis, the elevation so to speak, most quickly. In the one parameter 2D case, we took the slope to find this. In multidimensional mathematics, this direction is referred to as a gradient. The gradient is essentially multivariable slope, where we have a vector of partial derivatives to find the gradient of steepest descent, or for the case of deep learning, descent. Please note, this is an extremely layman's explanation of this concept in multivariable calculus. Coming back on topic, now you can see why this method in deep learning is referred to as gradient descent. In fact, even in the 2D case, we can still technically consider the slope as a gradient with a one-dimensional vector. Hence, we call this entire process of reaching a minimum value, gradient descent. No matter how many weighted parameters we have, we can apply gradient descent the same way. So in our case, we would take a vector of 181 weights, which is in 182 dimensional space, and then apply the gradient algorithm to compute which direction to move in. If we look at our cost function gradient vector, we can see the values of all the weights, with each step this function is taking having the goal to minimize the cost by changing the weighted values. To apply the change in weights that the cost function determines at the output, the values must be sent back through all the layers, in other words, backpropagation. This takes place with every piece of training data in which the cost function is running. As a quick disclaimer, I will not go into the mathematics for backpropagation, as it is beyond the scope of this video and would take quite some time to explain how the value gets propagated back through all the activation functions and assigned to each node. For a quick TLDR, its derivatives, the chain rule, and other advanced calculus methods. As stated in the disclaimer at the start of all these videos, there are plenty of great resources online to learn more about it, such as this video by 3blue1brown. Coming back on topic, if the parameters of our system, the weights are the knobs, then gradient descent is the method for determining what value to set the knobs to, and backpropagation actually tuning them to that value. This process then repeats while we are training the network until the weights are at a point where they are producing the results we expect to see. In other words, our cost function has achieved the desired low value. In other words, our utter trash values have now been transformed into values at or close to the ground truth values. If we have set our network up correctly over the past two videos, then after training for a sufficient amount of time, we would expect to see a similar network to the idealized one we set up in the last video. That being, eventually our gradient vector would end up settling on having the weights with similar connection strengths after landing in some minima. So, if you break it down, the general concept behind neural networks is fairly simple. They are comprised of many simple units, nodes, communicating with one another, and optimizing over some objective function. This objective function is a cost function, and we are optimizing for its minimum value. This is similar to what Pedro Domingues stated in his book, The Master Algorithm, that each of the five tribes of machine learning have three primary components: representation, evaluation, and optimization. For the state-of-the-art in the tribe of connectionism, our representation is done by the neural net function, taking in an input and parameters to reach a desired output. Essentially, we are defining a representation space. Next, the evaluation is done when we calculate the squared error of our nodes at the output and sum them up to get a cost function, or as some would call it, a utility function that describes how well our model is defining the data we are giving it. Finally, the optimization is how we search the space of representation models to obtain better evaluations. Or in other words, gradient descent and backpropagation is updating our network with this optimization. And all of these systems working together is what the learning and deep learning is: representation plus evaluation plus optimization. Now to wrap things up, even with the level of detail we have gone to in these past videos, there are still many things we didn't cover and made assumptions and generalizations about. For instance, we've made some broad generalizations here about how in theory artificial neural networks should work versus how they actually do. In theory, we'd hope the network would arrange itself in perfect layers of abstraction, with one layer doing vertical lines and the next combining those vertical lines. In actuality, there's a lot more randomness to it, as the neural net's cost function doesn't always land on the global minimum. Different types of networks, such as convolutional nets, fix this issue, as we'll see in a future video in this series. Additionally, much of the mathematics behind these networks wasn't discussed. As stated in the disclaimer at the start of these videos, my goal is to simplify in reality very complex topics and present them in a visually appealing way. There are various sources on this platform and around the web you can utilize to learn more. Speaking of simplifying complex topics, one such now more than ever is your privacy online, and tools such as VPNs are able to provide this by encrypting your internet connection. One such VPN I use myself and is a sponsor of this video is Surfshark. They use a military-grade AES-256 GCM encryption, which is used by banks and financial institutions around the world. Surfshark is also one of the few truly no-log VPNs out there, as they are based in the British Virgin Islands, which has no data retention laws. Moving on to the features of this VPN, they are supported by all major platforms, including Android and iOS. Some other great features that give me ease of mind is a kill switch feature, which will automatically terminate your internet connection if the VPN connection drops unexpectedly, and hack lock, which is a feature which will scan the web and notify you of vulnerable emails and passwords from data leaks. While there are many VPN options out there, Surfshark has become one of my favorites, and as a bonus, is also one of the most affordable as well. To support Futurology and learn more about Surfshark, go to surfshark.deals/futurology. By using this link and entering the code Futurology at checkout, you'll save 83%, as well as get 3 additional months to your plan for free, with a no-hassle 30-day money-back guarantee. At this point, the video has concluded. We'd like to thank you for taking the time to watch it. If you enjoyed it, consider supporting us on Patreon or YouTube membership to keep this brand growing. And if you have any topic suggestions, please leave them in the comments below. Consider subscribing for more content, and check out our website and our parent company EarthOne for more information. This has been Ankur, you've been watching Futurology, and we'll see you again soon.